so that they took that report and said, you know, we're pretty much in the clear here. So that when I went back to them and said, folks, we've found something here that was unexpected, and these are the findings. We have, you know, mechanistic findings, leakage in the blood-brain barrier. We have formation of micronuclei indicating genetic damage. We have an increase in the risk of death from cancer. We have an increase in the risk of malignant tumors of the brain, and we have an increase in the risk of benign tumors of the auditory nerve. They said, thank you. We'll take it from here.
Oh, my God.
And they also said, you're about out of money now, aren't you? And I said, well, yes, you know, we've completed the program. And they said, okay, well, that's good, too. And I went back to our folks, and I said, well, the industry basically doesn't want us to say anything about this because they're going to do the right thing.
You believed that at that time.
And this was in February of 1999. And I believed it because, quite honestly, I wanted to believe it. Now, by the end of February and into March, it became very clear that the industry was not only moving away from a public disclosure of the findings, but they were already making moves to try to distance themselves from me and the program, as well as they were planting information on the internet that was discrediting to me and my integrity.
You were too hot to handle. They had to get away.
And unfortunately, in April of 1999, the findings that we had, now the process that we put in place involved peer review with the Harvard School of Public Health. So all of these findings, these studies, these 56 different studies, all of those studies had to go through a peer review process that was coordinated through Harvard and Dr. John Graham, who headed that institute. And that process took 2, 3, 4, 5 months. So that when we had these findings at the end of 1998 and the beginning of 1999, we sent those findings into the peer review process. And while that peer review process was going on, I myself and everybody within the WTR were not talking publicly about the findings because they were not peer reviewed. So that they needed to be peer reviewed for scientific reasons. And we had always, through the 6 years of the program, waited until peer review was complete before we spoke publicly about findings. What the government had done was, because they wanted to see what we were doing while we ran this program for 6 years, but they did not want to jump too deeply into it because they didn't want to be accountable if the findings turned out as they did. Government put in place an interagency working group, an official interagency government working group that was headed by the FDA that included representatives from the Federal Communications Commission, the Environmental Protection Agency, Food and Drug Administration, the National Institute for Occupational Safety and Health, the National Institute for Environmental Health Sciences, and the Occupational Safety and Health Administration.
That's a pretty big list.
So that all of the government scientific agencies had input into what we had done. So that what I did was send all of the findings to the interagency working group in February of 1999. At the same time, we sent those findings to Harvard for peer review so that we could have the government peer review as well as the Harvard peer review. It turns out, Washington being Washington, somebody from within the interagency working group leaked the findings to the Washington Post. So in April of 1999, one Saturday morning, I was awoken by a call at 6:30 in the morning at my house, and it was Tom Wheeler, the head of the CTIA.
The Wireless Association.
The Wireless Trade Association, And he was livid. He was absolutely livid. He said, what do you intend to do about this? What are you? And I said, Tom, what are you talking about? 6:30 in the morning. He said, have you read the Post? And I said, no.
I was sleeping.
Sleeping, you know. So in the Washington Post, there was an article by John Schwartz, front page, above the fold.
Above the fold.
And it basically said cell phones cause cancer. And the article, of course, you know, had our findings in there. And they had a quote from me at the end of the article that said that, you know, I use a cell phone, but I use a headset.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And that I think that everybody should use a headset, you know, to move the antenna away from your body while we sort all this out. And that was the thing that had the industry more upset than anything.
The headset thing?
Yes. The fact that I said that don't use a phone without a headset. And of course they were upset about the findings and the leak and all of that, but the fact that I used a headset really, for some reason, just got them, you know.
That's really puzzling in a way, because they could sell headsets and...
But at the time, they weren't. Mm-hmm. You know, there were no headsets and phones, and, you know, it was an added accessory, that kind of thing. So what ended up happening was that once that leak occurred in the Washington Post, we were inundated with media requests from around the world, including ABC 2020, CBS's 60 Minutes, NBC's Dateline, so that it was triggered by that leak.
Your life changed overnight.
Well, it changed in a very weird way at that time, because the peer review wasn't completed, and we were going to follow the rules, so that we had set a time for June in Long Beach, California.
My birthday. Really? In Long Beach?
In Long Beach, California, to release the findings at a colloquium in June. So that our thinking was that, you know, the peer review process would have time to be finished. We could, you know, wrap up all of the findings and then in June release the findings publicly with peer review completed and all of that. Well, in April, when the findings were leaked to the Washington Post, the media sort of converged on us wanting to have the stories. And we weren't talking to anybody. And it got to the point where, you know, I was leaving my office through the back door because media were camping out on the front door. And it was a very hectic time, but we were committed to following the rules. When the peer review was done, then we would talk about the findings. So we made it to June. We went to Long Beach, had our colloquium, but in the time intervening between April and June, I had interactions with the industry that could be characterized as nothing other than threatening. And the whole process was Washington in motion at its worst, because there were threats on my financial well-being, on my reputation, and threats on my physical well-being. And I think that the entire process was the way it was because the cell phone industry did not look at this as a public health and safety issue.